Welcome to Checkpoint This Week. My name is Vivian Kansime. Now, on Monday, 15th of January, the 19th Non-Aligned Movement Summit kicked off at Speak Resort Munyonyo, where heads of states and senior government officials are in attendance. Today, we want to find out, what does it mean for a country like Uganda to host this summit in the face of sanctions from the West? My guest is Ambassador Adonia Ayebare, Uganda's permanent representative to the United Nations. Ambassador, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Vivian, for having me.
I will go down to the questions because this is the first time Uganda is hosting the Non-Aligned Movement Summit, and we shall also be hosting the Group of 77 plus China just this coming week. We have sunk lots of money to prepare for these summits, and Speak Resort Munyonyo alone was given 47 billion shillings to construct a conference facility. Over 60 billion shillings has been sunk into preparing for these summits. What will Uganda gain from hosting this particular summit?
Thank you. That's an excellent question. They say, you know, diplomacy is very expensive. When you're going to host, this is the first time any country hosts these summits together. The Non-Aligned Movement and it's the Third South Summit, also known as G77. So this is a huge gathering. I will give in comparative terms, you compare it with the UN General Assembly, it's the second. Because for the G77, there are 134 countries plus China. You know, for NAM, 120. The UN General Assembly, 193. So more than almost 80% of the countries in the world will be represented here. So that's huge. And it's expensive. And what will Uganda gain? Uganda will gain a lot. First of all, you are going to have almost 1,500 people in town. They will do a lot of things. They will eat, they will drink. Some might decide to stay and, you know, be tourists. And the tourist is defined as somebody who stays in a country more than 3 days and spends money. And all of them will spend here more than 3 days and they will spend money. So they qualify as tourists, even if they don't go anywhere out of Kampala. So it's huge. Uganda will benefit from that. All sorts of vendors will benefit. People who sell food, hotels are full. You know, the major hotels are full. You know, cars are being hired. So there is a direct benefit, but that's not all. That's tiny. Then there is the country's image. That's number two. The spotlight will be on Uganda. And even people who have not been here, I have friends who are coming to Uganda for the first time to attend NAM and G77. And the impression they get will really last, and you never know what will happen. They might come and invest, they might visit, they might decide to live here. So that is another. Then the most important benefit that is not seen, that is intangible, is the leverage of the diplomatic clout Uganda will have. You know, after the summits, these summits will be over on 23rd, but Uganda will resume chairing these two bodies at the international stage. NAM, for example, the Coordination Bureau is based in New York. The ambassador of Uganda at the UN, who happens to be me, will be the chair. The G77 at the same time. And it's also the first time one country chairs the two. And these forums really are influential. You look at the countries. When the Non-Aligned Movement started in the 1960s, it was full of countries who would have come independent. Now it's full of rich countries.
And They've developed.
They have developed. Look at ASEAN. ASEAN is not the whole of Asia, Southeast Asia. ASEAN organization has, I think, 11 member states, Vietnam, Cambodia, Singapore, and others. $6.5 trillion economy. You know, I know Ugandans go to Vietnam to trade. So if Uganda is chairing NAM and G77, we automatically have a good relationship with these countries. We can leverage. The point is, do we have a strategy to leverage this so that our country can benefit? Yes, we're working on it. You know, we also, I mean, by the virtue of being chair, we will have these contacts. We can have investment, we can have technology transfer, we can have many, many things. Innovation. These countries are really, really advanced in terms of technology. Look at Vietnam. Their telecoms are advanced. You know, they have invested in African countries already, Mozambique, Burundi, and others. And like things like internet are cheap. We can learn a lot from them. So those are the three areas where Uganda can benefit.
Okay, so let's put things into perspective here. You are one of Uganda's finest diplomats.
Oh, thank you.
Yes.
You make me feel better this evening.
And the common person has been inconvenienced. Mm-hmm. What does it mean for us to host this country? I know you've talked about the tourists who are going to be here, how much they're going to give us dollars, the much needed forex that we need here. But the common man is being inconvenienced.
Yeah.
The borders have been chased off their stages. Those who have flights at the airport may experience delays because of the traffic. We have traffic diversions going on. What are your thoughts on that?
I'm so sorry, but I am also the deputy chair, CEO of the National Organizing Committee. I deputize the head of public service, Madam Lucy Nachovi. We have really called upon those responsible, the security services, civil aviation authority at the airport, to really make it convenient for the local people to go around their business and to really designate routes where the guests will use, but business should continue. But I mean, I have lived in these diplomatic capital cities like Addis Ababa, now New York. When we have the General Assembly in New York, New Yorkers don't like September. Everybody goes for vacation because of closures. Where there are VIPs, because of security, that's unavoidable. But in this case, we really make sure that life is really smooth for a normal Ugandan to go with their duties.
Okay. Uganda is currently under sanctions. How did we land this opportunity?
Uganda is not under sanctions.
The prison's boss the other day was sanctioned.
And there are two kind of sanctions, Vivian. There are sanctions against individuals and there are sanctions against the country. So what is happening is called targeted sanctions, and they are unilateral. They are not even international. They are countries like the US. They, in their policies, they have a sovereign right to sanction individuals whom they think are transgressing against their values, which they cherish, human rights and others. But that's not to say that Uganda is under sanctions, because that's a huge distinction. You know, if a country is under sanctions, you will feel it. These are individuals. It is, you can't travel to the US. If you have assets or money in the US, they are frozen. But that is not Uganda.
Well, Uganda just had a ban from AGOA, so we can't trade in that space, in that particular, under that particular arrangement or under that AGOA deal. So that's one sanction under the United States deal, the AGOA deal on us. So don't these affect our ability to land opportunities like this?
No. This is again another, this is unilateral again. Measure, and it's not really, but it's a suspension. You know, we have some disagreements and some issues we are discussing live as we talk. They suspended Uganda, and it's their right again, because this is preferential treatment in trade, that you can access our market as the US, but these are conditions. But that's not to mean that the country has been sanctioned. We continue to trade with the US in other areas. We continue big investments. You're familiar with the discussions on the refinery by US company. You know, Boeing is discussing with Uganda Airlines for possible cooperation. And we continue really even cooperating on other strategic things with the US. It's only on these few areas where we have misunderstandings, which are really fixable. So it's not true to say that Uganda is under sanctions, because that's not true.
Do you take part in lobbying for conferences like this?
Of course, that's how I make my living. That's how I earn my living, is to promote Uganda. Investment, tourism, And these are, especially these two conferences are really unique. They are, you can call them political, diplomatic. Countries compete for them, to host them. But we were kind of a lot of work, but also lucky. Non-aligned movement goes around different regions of the world, Africa, Asia, Latin America, Middle East. And we were lucky that it was a turn for Africa. And among Africans, we had our internal competition. And Uganda was selected to represent Africa and host NAM. For the third South Summit, which is G77, we were supposed to host it before COVID, 2019. So it was postponed. It's by coincidence that after it was postponed, we landed in NAM. And then we, in 2020. So a decision was taken that why don't we run them back to back? And also, of course, chair them. So it's no country has ever got that chance to do that. So we have an opportunity to really do a lot of things in terms of representing these countries at the global stage.
So after these summits, we are going to be chairing NAM for 3 years, for the next 3 years, and then the G77 for 1 year. How are we prepared to take this on?
You know, what keeps me awake at night is not the summits, because I think the summits are going to go well. It's the chairing. It's a huge task. You can imagine, Vivian, 120 countries in NAM. Very diverse, different regions, different cultures, different levels of development, different politics, coordinating them to have a common position and defend it on their behalf. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of lobbying. But I've been privileged to really have an experience in multilateralism, diplomacy at the UN and the African Union and others. And I'm a person who gets along with everybody. But also you have to be technically, competent to do it. And I also have a good team. First of all, I have a supportive structure of my bosses at the Minister of Foreign Affairs and a head of state who is really the chair. But the daily business is done out of New York. The coordinating bureau of NAM, of all ambassadors, is where, according to NAM rules, is where we coordinate daily business. But I'll have to consult the head of state, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, almost every day. And then it's up to me to do the job and do it well so that I don't embarrass Uganda at the international stage. Then G77 is even, I call it a live wire at the UN. You cannot do anything at the UN if the G77 is not on board. We are the majority member states. So Uganda will have to coordinate the G77 well so that all these countries can participate in the UN processes like climate change, debt, digital transformation, and all those.
So, Ambassador, I know everyone has their eyes on the budgets. The budgets I just mentioned, the over 60 billion shillings budget for preparing all these summits. But at what cost shall we be doing all that?
Let me tell you, I think this is one of the low-cost conferences we have hosted. Okay, apart from the big chunk of funds that went into the conference center, which is, by the way, a joint venture. You, as a Ugandan, you have a share in Munyonyo because it's a joint venture, 50-50, between the government and Munyonyo Speak Resort. So that's an investment. And you talked about investment and tourism promotion. That facility will really make Uganda a venue for conferences. And with that facility, we can attract a lot of conferences and with all the benefits that come with conferences. So it's really important that we understand that this money is an investment. And most of the few funds have gone into, of course, hiring the meeting rooms, hotel rooms for guests. That is it. But unlike other summits we have hosted in the past, we didn't buy cars. We instead got cars from friendly countries for free. And also we used government cars. So that saved a huge, huge, you can imagine if we had bought a fleet of cars. Billions of shillings. That didn't happen. We have been really frugal. We have asked government departments involved to use their budgets. They only use the budget of NAM for extra things that are not in their normal operations. like the airport, that terminal was already in construction. What we did was to really work with them to make sure it's completed on time.
To speed up the works. What kind of impression do we want these visitors to take of Uganda? Because yes, you're talking about tourism, and you're talking about the investment they're going to do here as tourists and all. But what kind of impression on the whole do we want them to have of our country?
I think we want them to have a lasting positive impression of Uganda. Already my friends whom I work with in New York have just landed, and one of the first observations I've not even seen was that this place is so green. People are so friendly. We were welcomed, and one of them told me he has never been greeted many times in a day, and yet he has been here only for 6 hours. You can imagine, he said he's not used to being greeted like that. So
our hospitality,
we are hospitable people. So that is really good, and they will have a lasting impression, and they will come back.
Does Uganda have enough hotel rooms for these guests?
I'm really impressed. I think over the years, I didn't know until I started working on these two summits, the capacity we have developed. We have enough hotel rooms. They are full, but they are there. And there's been tremendous investments in hospitality, especially hotels.
The presidential suites, do we have enough of the presidential suites for our guests?
Like almost 80% of heads of delegations are in Munyonyo. Munyonyo invested during Chogam in presidential suites, I think over 60. So that is, then others are staying with Serena, Sheraton. We have 4 points. Sheraton is new. Brandon knew I was there the other day for the first time. It's like I was, you know, could be have been in Dubai or New York. So, you know, Protea, Mestil is a fantastic hotel. So it's really impressive that we have this capacity.
As of late, a few days ago, the conference center that you said government has invested in partnership with Peak Resort Munyonyo has been under construction. And we have done things last minute. Some people, in fact, are saying that Idi Amin had better preparations for the organization of African Union summit in the 1970s, because the conference center, which is supposed to be hosting this summit, is still having lights being fixed. They are still finishing a bit of works here and there. Why did we do things at the last minute?
No, I think you should appreciate that we were given this offer to host the summit under 2 years ago, 18 months. And you can imagine, you know how we used to host meetings in Marquis. And such a meeting in Marquis would have really been terrible. So we should credit Mr. Sudhir and his team that 1 year, exactly 1 year ago, they broke ground and they have finished a magnificent. There are few places in the world where you find such a structure built under a year. It's not that there was lack of planning. You have to get a meeting and then plan. And I think really Uganda should be appreciative. Of course, it's their taxpayers, it's their tax money, but that has been completed on time. It's a good structure. It is going to leave a lasting impression on Uganda. It's really completed. It's not easy to put these functions together. I've been to meetings where we go and the conference, 2 days to the conference, is still being painted. But this is done and ready.
It's not only the conference center, Ambassador, it's also the roads that are still being painted, cleaned up. We are still doing some gardening on our roads, some beautifying here and there. Clearly, we have just filled up potholes in the city. There is that last minute effort to ensure that the place is good enough for the conference. What lessons do we have to draw from this?
Clearly, we have to really, the lesson is that we need to prepare better. Nothing is perfect. Even in our social settings, when you have a function is when you, I mean, I've lived in these cities like New York that host big meetings, but there is always preparations. There's a big hotel next to my embassy that always hosts president. This meetings is always in September. They start painting like 2 weeks. It's normal, but we could do it better. I think the fact that we have done this, the airport, the roads, the convention center, will leave a lasting impression. and maybe the future meetings will be better organized. Eh? But you should appreciate the challenge that these meetings are lobbied for, and you are not in charge of the calendar. They will give you a meeting and they will tell you 6 months we want you to host. So I think the most important is to have pre-existing infrastructure. Like we had Munyonyo. Can you imagine if we didn't have Munyonyo for Chogam? Where would we have got those presidential suites? Now that we have a convention center, now the issue of roads and cleanliness, I think should we really need a conversation as Ugandans, what kind of city do we need? Not when we get visitors. I think this discussion has started. You know, people are, why did you chase away vendors? I mean, trading in a reserve road, constructing in a sewage, canal is really not right. It's even illegal. So I think we need a conversation. How do we do humanity? How do we live in a clean city? So that it becomes easy to host a conference without cleaning up.
Well, like you said, Uganda has put up this magnificent building for this summit. And we know that our neighbors have been positioning themselves in the region as a destination for conferences. How can Uganda now position itself for as a destination for conferences? Because we are going to have AFCON in 2027. How can we showcase all these facilities? You say our hospitality has improved. We had Chogam in 2007. Have we made all these gains for nothing? How can we position ourselves?
I think we don't need to compete with neighbors. There is much to go around. There is a lot of conferences. There are a lot of events that everybody in East Africa can benefit. Uganda has been disadvantaged because we don't have facilities. But now we have facilities, so our share, our rightful share, will get it. But we need also to really be aggressive at marketing the country. You know, but also now we have an airline. But maybe we need to improve in shopping more so that people can come for conferences and shop. So we need a whole approach, country approach, where the private sector is involved, the government is involved, so that we can really have a comprehensive, sustainable strategy to attract investment, but also tourism and conferences to Uganda.
So let's now look at the non-aligned movement itself, what purpose it was it was formed for. We know that it was formed in the times of the Cold War, and the capitalists and the socialists were at war, and that era has now ended. Hasn't NAM outlived its usefulness?
No. It has not. You know, when you look at the principles that really established NAM, the Bandung principles, you know, respect for international law, you know, respect for human rights, and really friendliness among countries, and denuclearization, are still as valid as they were in the 60s now. Then the mission, the purpose why NAM was created, was decolonization. That was mission accomplished. But it also talked about, you know, after decolonization, so what? It talked about political independence and economic development. And these are ongoing projects. But most importantly is that countries like Uganda, developing countries, have to work in a group, like NAM and G77, in order to have leverage and bargaining power on the international scene. So that is valid now with the geopolitics. You can imagine if Uganda was negotiating with the European Union alone, we will not do it. We don't have that influence and power. But when we go as G77, we have influence and power, or NAM. So these organizations actually are more relevant now. And NAM is not the NAM of the 60s. These countries are really, like I said, really rich countries that can really help each other.
So when was the last time, or on what issues did we last see these NAM states standing together?
Oh, we've been having votes at the UN on the issue, the question of Palestine, where the majority, the voting is of course a sovereign issue. Countries vote according to their interests, but NAM really coordinates on issues of Palestine, G77 on all issues, climate change. I've just been, was in Dubai during COP, where G77 was influential in the outcome of COPs, especially on financing. You know, the loss and damage fund, you know, you have seen these bad adverse weather conditions, El Nino, sweeping away bridges in developing countries, roads. There is a fund now which you can apply on emergency terms, not as a loan, as grants, which has been negotiated by the group of 77. The issue of debt, you know, countries like Uganda, the debt is a problem. Basically, you spend most of your tax and, you know, hand and foreign exchange in settling the debt. Sometimes 50%, 70% of the funds or of the income of countries go to settling debts. That issue is being handled by the group of 77. And if we get a breakthrough, you know, countries like Uganda benefit. And that has to be done in a group.
What role has NAM played, for example, in the Israel-Gaza war that is currently going on?
NAM was formed to address issues like Palestine. On the sidelines of the Kampala summit, apart from the final outcome document, which is being negotiated starting on Monday, 15th, and I delayed in a meeting trying to prepare to chair that meeting. You know, I've been privileged to be selected to lead the senior officials' negotiations. That outcome document has a lot of language on Palestine, on issues of Palestine. But on top of that, we have a ministerial meeting on Palestine, standalone.
So what is your stand?
Specifically. Uganda is that this conflict has to end. There has to be a humanitarian pause and maybe a truce so that, you know, women and children have to stop dying. And they cannot stop if there is, we cannot achieve anything if there is war. But looking in the future, the two-state solution, existing by side and side in peace. And that's the position of Uganda, and that's how we have been voting at the UN.
Okay. The world is slowly returning to the days of the Cold War. I don't know if you agree, but weak countries are being invaded by strong countries. And NAM, you know, was formed to protect these developing countries. How can NAM be strengthened to secure interests of the member countries in the face of this kind of aggression on these developing countries?
NAM was formed during the Cold War, where you had to choose between the Soviet Union, which was called the Eastern Bloc, and the US, which led the Western countries. But since the Cold War has been over, now we are, you know, and of course the US dominated for some time, unipolar, and now we are in a multipolar world where there are many, many power centers. It's not two, it's not three, there are many power centers. The European Union, the BRICS, mention it, Russia, China, US. So this multipolarity is an opportunity, but also a challenge in terms of how you navigate. And again, a country like Uganda cannot navigate this complexity. You need an organization like NAM, where you participate as a group, and G77, to really be able to benefit. You can imagine dealing with the European Union at the UN. You know, if you are Uganda, they do not even give you 2 minutes. But if you are a bloc of countries, 134, you will have influence. The numbers matter in international relations, and economic power also matters. And G77 is that kind of a NAM, that kind of addressing multipolarity. So, of course, the big powers will also pursue their interests, but they will need organized developing countries to really push back.
So, back to our summit that we are having this week, and we will be expecting the G77 plus China next week. Are there resolutions that are going to be made at the end of this summit? And if there are, what kind of resolutions are they?
The G77, the Third South Summit, will also have an outcome document. Mm-hmm. And that outcome document is mainly economic. You know, really heavy economics. You know, the contemporary issues, of, like I mentioned, of debt, you know, have to be addressed by developing countries, you have heard about the Paris Club, the club of lenders. Mm. But if we could coordinate the developing countries and also have a club of borrowers so that we can negotiate good terms, those are the ideas being floated in the document. The issue of how do we decisively deal with debt. But also financing for development, you are familiar with SDGs. All the studies show that we are all lagging behind, and it's 7 years to go. So how do we mobilize finance? As you know, all these international financial institutions like the World Bank and IMF really disadvantage developing countries. Their reform has been long overdue. And this year, we have a big, big process at the UN called the Summit of the Future, which will result into the Pact of the Future. And negotiations have already started. Uganda, this is a historic opportunity. It has not happened in 50 years. Uganda will be chairing the G77 that will really take a lead in negotiating for developing countries. How do we reform these institutions? Look at the IMF. We are familiar with the special drawing rights, SDRs, that are really monopolized by developed countries. So post-COVID, every country, including rich countries, wanted to borrow, were looking for money. But developing countries could not access these finances because these institutions really favor developed countries. How do we reform them to be fit for purpose for this century so that developing countries can benefit?
Well, His Excellency Ambassador Adoniyi Ayeri, we are taking a short break. We will be back